one I'll do for you. And church today, he carried me back this morning in the wee hours as I was laying there praying and seeking him. He told me about Elijah. He started talking about Elijah. And he said, you know, Elijah thought that he had done it all. Elijah thought that he had met the end of his rope. And Elijah was praying to me, God, take my life. I'm tired. I'm the only one left. But he reminded him that he had a few men that had not bowed down to the devil. He had a few men that was left. And he told Elijah, he said, Elijah, I want you to go down to the tree there, bound down by the brook of Cherith. And he said, sit by the brook. Now, you've told them all that there's going to be a drought. You've been obedient to me. You've followed my word. You've followed my direction. And he said, listen, there's going to be a drought in the land. But he said, son, I'm going to take care of you through the drought. I'm going to take care of you through the hard times. I'm going to take care of you, my son, because I'm the one that's going to command the ravens to bring you bread. I'm going to command the birds to bring you a piece of meat, and you're going to drink from the brook, because there's going to be water in that brook. As long as I tell that brook to run, it's going to bring forth water. And he said, you go, and I'll take care of you, because you've been obedient to me. And this is exactly what he's trying to tell the church today. He's saying, listen, as long as I'm in control, as long as you follow my steps and follow my words, I will take care of you. I'll sustain you, and I'll make sure that, praise God, if I have to send the bird to bring you something to eat, you're not going to go hungry, you're not going to go naked, and you're not going to do without. Because God can and God will. The Bible says over there in Kings, he said it wasn't long. He said God commanded the birds, the ravens, and the ravens brought him bread and meat every morning and bread and meat every evening. God wasn't going to tell him to live off of one meal a day. Every morning, Elijah would wake up, go down by the brook, get him a cold drink of water. And there was breakfast. He had bread and meat. I don't know if it was ham and eggs or ham biscuits or sausage biscuits or what kind of bread and meat they were bringing. But Elijah knew to give thanks to God, because God said he would take care of him. Elijah got up one morning, went down to the brook, and there was no water. No water. But the Lord spoke to Elijah. Said, Elijah, I'm going to move you from the brook. But I've already told you that I'd take care of you. Just as I commanded the ravens to bring you bread and to bring you meat, I've commanded a widow woman to take care of you. Because you've been obedient, because you've sit here, because you've been obedient to my word, I told you to sit by the river and I would bring you water, and you never doubted it. I told you to sit by the river and I would bring you bread, and you never doubted it. I told you to sit by the river and I'd bring you meat, and you never doubted it. You sit there day in and day out, day in and day out, awaiting and placing your trust in me. You didn't go out hunting, try to find food. You didn't go out knocking on doors and begging for bread. You didn't have to do anything. You listened to me and you were obedient, and now I've asked, I've commanded a widow to feed you. I don't know how hot the bread was that the birds were bringing. I don't know how warm it was, but God said, I'm going to give it to you straight out of the oven. You've been obedient, and you've eaten some cool bread or even cold bread. But he said, I'm going to give you some hot biscuits now. He said, you go to this widow's house. And you know what the story is. Elijah went walking up to the widow's house that day. And praise God, she was out there gathering up sticks. And she said, I'm fixing to cook my last little cake. And me and my son, we're going to die. But you see, God had another plan. He had a plan for her also. And I'm telling you, church, that no matter where you're at today, God's got a plan for you. He sent the man of God, and the man of God said, listen, you just do what I say, because I'm telling you what God has told me. And here again, it comes down to obedience. She had to listen to the man of God. And as the man of God told her what to do, he said, you go bake me a cake first, and my God will sustain you. My God will take care of your son. My God will take care of your household. And it's the same way today. He's no respecter of person. He's the same Lord yesterday. He's the same God today. And he's going to be the same God tomorrow. He's not going to change his word. Somebody was talking to me yesterday, and we were talking about how that some people say, well, God doing this and God's doing that. God's not going to change his word for you. He's not going to change his word for me. He's not going to change the word in that Bible for no man. If he says yes in the Bible, you better believe it, yes. If he says no in the Bible, you better count it no, because God is not going to change. He's not going to change. Heaven and earth are going to be renovated. Heaven and earth are going to pass away. The heavens and earth that we know now are going to be changed. But he said, my word is not going to be changed. And church, this is where he's at today. We're so close. Brother David, you're a fanatic. I might be. If I am, just leave me alone. Because if it's of self, it's going to come to naught. But if God's telling me, if God's in it, it's going to come to pass. You understand what I'm saying? If God's in anything that I do, it's going to be exalted, and it's going to come up, and God's going to get the glory out of it. If it's of flesh, if it's of self, then it'll come to naught. I don't set times. I don't set schedules. I don't tell you the dates or the months or the years that Christ is coming, but I will tell you that he's coming, and I'm telling you, you better be ready, because when he comes, there's not going to be time to go find you an altar. There's not going to be time to catch up on your tithes and offerings. There's not going to be any time, hallelujah, to find mom and daddy, or find the preacher, or learn the scripture, or read the word, or learn how to pray. It's not going to have any time. You're not going to have time. He said, I'm coming as a thief in the night. I'm not going to send you a telegram. I'm not going to send you a telephone call. I'm not going to write you a letter. I'm going to come in the wee hours of the morning. I'm going to come as a thief in the night, and I'm going to knock on your heart's door, and your heart's going to cease to beat, and your breath is going to cease to breathe, and you're coming out of that shell. Your soul is going to be required of you. And if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're going to appear before King Jesus, and your works are going to be judged. If your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're going to be opening your eyes in hell, in torment. From the very second you open them, you're going to be in torment. Luke 16. And you're going to be standing before Lucifer. And you're going to stay there a minimum of 1,007 years. Because you're going to be there through great tribulation period. Should you die before the rapture, there's going to be 7 years of tribulation poured out upon this earth. You're also going to be there for the 1,000-year millennial reign. The time that the saints of God are ruling and reigning with Jesus here on this earth. You're going to still be in hell. Because you've rejected the only ticket out, the only way out, his name is Jesus. And you've rejected him. So you're going to spend 1,007 years in torment. Your tongue will swell. You'll be so thirsty. You'll be crying out for just a drop of water. The worms will be gnawing on you. You say, well, hold it, my body's going to be in the ground. That's right. But your body's still going with your soul man. Still has a body. Your soul man still has a shape. He still has a form. The rich man opened his eyes in hell and looked across hell, and he saw the beggar. He recognized the beggar. Why? The Bible says, you shall know as you were known. Even though Lazarus's body was laying back upon the earth and buried, then the rich man's body was laying back upon the earth and buried. He looked across hell until he looked across the gulf, and he looked in Abraham's bosom, and he said, my goodness, there's the beggar that used to be out at my gate. He recognized him. Why? Because even though his body was back on the earth, his soul man had the appearance, the same appearance. His soul man had the same shape. His soul man had the same look that his natural body had. And the rich man saw him over there, and he said, Abraham, oh Father Abraham, send him over here and let him dip his finger in the water and touch my lips touch my tongue, for I perish. I'm in torment. I'm thirsty. And you see, you're going to have to stay in that hell-bound place for at least 1,000 years, 1,007 years. And then when you're delivered up, you're going to be rejoicing to get out of hell. You're going to be rejoicing, hallelujah, as your soul comes up out of the flames. You're going to be rejoicing, and you're going to be so happy to see King Jesus. You're going to be so happy to see God Jehovah when you come up out of that hell. And all of a sudden, you're going to see this white throne, and that white throne is going to be set before you, and him seated on the throne of it will be God Jehovah. And as you come before the great white throne judgment, he's going to open up the books of judgment. He's going to open up a set of books. It's going to have your name written in it, and every sin you've committed from the day you were born.